Good morning and welcome to another online worship service. This morning is the third Sunday of Easter. We are still in the season of Easter, celebrating the resurrected Jesus, living into this age of grace, this opportunity to have more connection with God each and every day by way of prayer, by way of worship, by way of reading scripture, having holy conversation. We get to live in this world of grace, and that is all because of this season of Easter. And so this morning I welcome you and hope that this is a blessing.
The scripture for today is from Luke chapter 24, 13 through 35. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day which these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they were indeed seeing a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory? Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures.
As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him and vanished from their sight. They stood to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us?" While he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us, that same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road, and now he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread.
Thank you so much, Bobby and John Edward. We turn now to our sermon. Things do not often turn out how we hoped they would turn out. I remember watching the New Year's Eve event on TV from New York with my family one year when I was a child, and there was a countdown, and everyone was so excited waiting for that countdown to reach zero. And I remember thinking to myself, what is going to happen? The countdown reached zero, and there was a moment of cheer in the household, and then everyone went to bed. I felt left. I felt let down. I had hoped that something amazing was going to happen, and it didn't. This is not a rare experience in human life. There are many times when we think to ourselves, when I graduate school, when I pay off this house, when my kids turn this age, when I retire, when I make this amount of money, then all will be well. Then that blessed day finally comes. We walk across that stage, we get the degree, we leave our retirement party, we pay our final bill. Our child is done with diapers. Yet life has presented new challenges. The finish line has now advanced down the road. We thought this would be the moment that life gets better. We had hoped things would be different. They weren't. They aren't. The countdown hit zero, and we just went to bed. There is another way of seeing things that we had hoped for in a different light. When something worked out differently than we thought it was going to, there can be opportunity for more than we ever imagined. In other words, experiencing a loss today might be part of a larger win tomorrow. Sometimes things don't work out like we hoped, but it moved us towards something new that we would have never experienced otherwise. We plan on graduating with a degree in engineering and have an issue with keeping up with all the math classes. So we have to look at other options. We find a different career that suits our talents, and we have success. We hoped for one thing, yet that did not happen like we imagined. And in this case, it was a good thing it happened, because our lives are equally enhanced by times when we don't get what we thought we wanted. As the philosopher Garth Brooks puts it, "Sometimes I thank God for unanswered prayers." It is difficult to always know that things will work out when, by all appearances, everything is failing. It is hard to have hope when the things we had hoped for did not come to fruition like we planned. Luke's gospel is a masterpiece of storytelling. I would encourage you to go back and read this passage again and again, because there is so much packed into it that we could talk about it for weeks and still find new things to talk about. Luke recounts this appearance of Jesus in such a familiar way that even 2,000 years later, it is not hard to imagine two people walking down a road, talking about current events, and bumping into a stranger. These two men are walking away from Jerusalem to Emmaus. Jesus was just crucified in Jerusalem, so maybe they are afraid since they were followers of Jesus. Maybe they are leaving Jerusalem because of this fear. We don't know. Nevertheless, these two men are walking down a road and talking about all that had happened with Jesus. What makes this story so compelling to read is the fact that Jesus joins the men on this walk, but they don't recognize that this is Jesus. What Jesus does next is worth noting because Jesus doesn't fill the gaps in their conversation about all that had happened in Jerusalem with Jesus. Rather, Jesus asks them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along the way?" The two men's response is something we can understand very easily right now. They say, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" It would be like if you were standing in a grocery store and someone came up to you and said, "Why are all these people wearing masks? Why are we having to stand so far apart from one another?" Like the two men, we would probably respond, "Are you the only stranger in the United States who does not know the things that have taken place here in these days?" Jesus obviously knows what has happened. He is the one the things happened to, obviously. Yet Jesus continues to operate from a place of wonder. He asks them, "What things? What's happened?" Jesus invites the two men to tell the story from how they experienced it. And I think there could be so much healing made available to us by learning to do the same thing in our own lives. That if we get in an argument with somebody, or if somebody is mad at us, instead of assuming we know what has happened or what is wrong, what would it look like to simply ask them to tell us the story of what happened? To pretend like we don't know, so that we can hear from someone else how our actions, how our words affect them. We might find that listening to others often leads to better outcomes and disagreements rather than assuming the answer. By Jesus doing this, by leaving the two men to tell the story themselves, Jesus is able to hear exactly what the two men need from him. They tell their story, and their story starts with their faith in Jesus as a prophet who was mighty in deed and word. And what I would like to spend some time this morning is to discuss what they say next. They have no doubt that this Jesus had come to change the world, that Jesus had come to do a new thing, and they just couldn't understand how this person named Jesus, who by all appearances was here to change things, would be handed over and murdered. They say to Jesus, who they still think is a stranger, we had hoped that he would be the one to redeem Israel. They said, "We had hoped." And there it is. That's what the two men needed from Jesus. Jesus has the wisdom to listen before speaking. And by asking the two men to share their story as if Jesus was unaware of all that had happened, he gave space for the two men to be honest about what they experienced. We had hoped that he would be the one to redeem Israel. And I think it is so important to hear them saying that they never doubted that this Jesus was a person who was unique and offered a renewed way of being in relationship with God through his mighty words and deeds. Yet how they imagined Jesus redeeming Israel did not look like death on a cross. Our point of pause this morning is around that very same insight. What kinds of things have we experienced in this lifetime that we thought God was going to do one thing and another thing happened? How many times have we heard and seen and even believed in the mighty words and deeds of Jesus, yet how God has moved in our situation was different than how we had hoped? We read stories of Jesus healing those who are afflicted, those who are suffering. Yet cancer and viruses and illnesses are still a part of our daily lives. We have seen the mighty words and deeds, yet our situation remains bleak. We had hoped things would be different. This morning, what I think is so important to hear from this passage is that Jesus reveals to these two men that there is still more to the story. By giving space for the two men to share their story, Jesus now knows how to respond to their most pressing need. They had hoped, and now they have no hope. They heard the women's testimony from the empty grave, and some had even gone and confirmed that the tomb was empty, yet they still did not see the entire picture. It's hard to see the picture when we're in the midst of difficulty. It is hard to see good news when, by all appearances, our situation feels like bad news. Jesus calls the two men to believe what had been declared by the prophets of the Old Testament, that the Messiah should suffer and then enter into his glory. That since Moses, the world has longed for this moment in history when all would seem lost, yet it is through that loss that glory has come. This morning we declare that what Jesus has said and done, by living and dying and rising again, Jesus has begun the work of redeeming a broken creation. That like these two men, when we journey down roads wondering why things happen the way they happen, we see that Jesus appears again to us to say that there is more to the story than just what we see. Jesus gives space to be honest about how we experience this life, and from that honesty, Jesus responds. And I think it is to our benefit this morning to understand that this Easter season we are living in is a chance to practice this truth, that we are surrounded by millions of reasons to lose all hope that God is at work in the midst of our circumstances. But the resurrection of Jesus demands that we look again. And what I would offer as well is that these men are not looking again by themselves. They are together. They are with one another in the midst of their feelings of lost hope. Where in our lives this morning have we felt a sense of lost hope? Jesus, I had hoped this pandemic would end so that I could graduate to celebrate my high school education, to celebrate my college education. Jesus, I had hoped that things would be back to normal so that we could do that thing that we planned to do. Can we be honest with God about the hope we no longer feel in a situation that we are dealing with? Can we have the courage and faithfulness to follow Jesus in looking again? Can we have faith that God will do something more than we are currently able to see right now? Our Christian hope is in the one who does not stay dead. Rather, we hope in the one who brings life out of death. We hope in the one who assures us that this story does not end without redemption. Whether we experience that redemption in this lifetime or not, we believe in the truth that Christ will come again, where sin, death, and suffering will meet their end. The most beautiful aspect of this passage is that Jesus does not leave the men until they have realized that this person they have been talking to the whole time was Jesus. They invite Jesus for a meal where Jesus breaks bread and gives it to them. And it is upon eating this bread that they recognize Jesus. And the final thing I would offer is that when our situation looks bleak, when our hope is gone, fellowship with friends, family, and even strangers, and in the two men's case, especially with a stranger, gives us the ability to look again. To look again at our situation and see that God has promised that joy comes in the morning. Jesus does not leave us without hope. Rather, Jesus hangs with us, shares with us, eats with us. Jesus will not leave us saying, "We had hoped." No, Jesus stays with us until we say, "I have In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Jesus, keep me from
morning. Welcome now to our children's sermon. Today we are looking at a text from Luke in the 24th chapter. It is two men on a walk down a road on their way to a place called Emmaus. They're walking down this road and they're having a conversation like you would with your friend, except they're talking about all the things that had just happened in Jerusalem where they were, you know, leaving from. And I'm sure you remember from over the last couple of weeks, we have talked about all the things that had happened in Jerusalem. That Jesus was put on the cross, that Jesus died and rose again on Easter Sunday, and we declared that Jesus is risen and that he is here. Except that the two men that are on this walk do not yet know that Jesus is risen. They're having this conversation as if Jesus is still in the tomb. And so while they're having this conversation, a man appears. Luke tells us that this man is Jesus appearing to these two men, except they don't recognize that it's Jesus. So Jesus asks them, "What are you talking about?" And they find that question so crazy because this was like the biggest news in the world at the moment. You know, this whole thing had just happened in Jerusalem with this very person that everybody believed was here to do a new thing, to change things, and they handed him over and he died on a cross. And they couldn't believe that this man was asking them, you know, what they were talking about when everybody knew that. And so they tell him what happened. Jesus tells them, or actually the two men tell Jesus all that had happened in Jerusalem. And when they're done, Jesus joins them in their home. They invite Jesus to come and to have a meal with them. And when Jesus breaks bread, like we do at communion, Jesus breaks bread and he gives it to them. And once they eat the bread, they realize that they're sitting with Jesus. And so what I would offer you this morning, and what I think is so amazing from this passage, is that these two men thought they met a stranger, except the stranger was Jesus. And what I would offer to you today is that when we extend invitation to people, even people we don't know, to join us in a conversation, to join us in a time of fellowship, of eating, when we invite people we don't know to church, that sometimes we might be surprised to meet Jesus in that other person. That Jesus tells us in another part of the Bible that what you do to the people that are the least in this world, those who are hungry, those who are in need, what you do to those people, you do to me. And so if we meet a stranger that's in need of something, and we invite them to join in our life, and we share with them the things that we have, we can, like these two men, meet Jesus in the strangers in whom we encounter. Like Jesus said, what we do to the least of these in our world, those who are hurting, who are in need, who are alone, we do to Jesus. And so these two men, they thought they met a stranger. Turns out it's Jesus. And I wonder, the next time we meet a stranger, if we can share with them the love of Christ, if we're with our parent who can keep us safe while we talk to the others that maybe we don't know. Maybe it's a classmate at school. Whenever we do finally get to go back to school and we meet a classmate we've never known before and we share with them, maybe we can see Jesus in them as well. So let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you, Lord, for the children of our church. We pray, Lord, that you would be with them. Help them, God, in the midst of taking classes online. Be with their teachers. Be with their parents. Be with all those who are struggling in the midst of the circumstances. And we thank you, God, for our children and ask that you bless them. In Jesus' name, amen.
We turn now this morning to our time of prayer, lifting up the needs in our lives, in our church, in our community that we know about. So this morning, I invite you to join me in this time of prayer. Gracious God, we thank you, Lord, again this morning for a worship service, Lord, in this weird and obscure way. We thank you, God, for this opportunity to gather together from afar, that, Lord, we can still show love to each other, that, Lord, we can still demonstrate and praise you,
Lord, and demonstrate our love for you from afar. Lord, we thank you for technology. We thank you for the gifts of it. And pray, Lord, that we would reach out with it to those, Lord, who need a word today. But Lord, we also yearn for the time in which we come back together. Lord, a time of being in church with one another, sharing in song and word and sacrament with you again. Lord, we ask that that day would come. And Lord, we pray and ask, Lord, that you would give us faithfulness and courage to weather these days together, to remember that we are not alone and that you are with us. Lord, we also lift up those this week who will have surgery, those who will have surgery without their family members waiting on them just outside the surgery room. Lord, we pray for those who are in the hospital who are by themselves. We pray for the doctors and the nurses and all the healthcare workers, Lord. And just ask, Lord, your protection upon them and their families. And Lord, we also lift up those who lost the families of those who lost loved ones in the storms of last week. We pray, Lord, that you would help those who lost their homes rebuild and be with those today who are suffering. And Lord, we finally lift up and give you thanks for Jesus in this Easter season, remembering, Lord, that we are people living in the resurrection of your Son. And because of that, Lord, our life will never be the same, and we can be in right relationship with you. And now, Lord, we pray the prayer that you have taught us to pray by saying the words, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever.
Thank you.
now, may the glory of the risen Jesus be with you as you go about this week. I pray that this week you meet Jesus in your conversations with others, that you meet Jesus in a time where perhaps you share with a stranger. I pray this week that you encounter Jesus when you're on your way. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.